Welcome to the Center for Climate and Security's Climate and Security Podcast. I'm your host, Dr. Shatha Chakraborty. Regular listeners will know that twice a month we aim to bring you exclusive dialogues with today's leading thinkers, educators, civil servants, and military personnel who work at the nexus of climate and security. I ask these experts to share with us their views and perspectives on how to best prepare for this time of high consequence risk, particularly that of climate change. Today's podcast guest is Christine Parthemore, who runs a program examining the nexus of climate, nuclear, and security issues at the Council on Strategic Risks. She has been a Council on Foreign Relations International Affairs Fellow in Japan and founder of the company CLP Global, which provides advice and research on international affairs. She has even served as a senior advisor to the Assistant Secretary of Defense for nuclear, chemical, and biological defense programs in the U.S. Department of Defense. So clearly there's a lot to break down here, Christine. Thank you so much for joining me today.
Thank you for having me.
So you are the director currently of the Climate Nuclear Security Program. Climate and nuclear are not two areas normally said together in the same sentence. How do these risk areas overlap? What would you say to listeners who wonder how these two come together? What are the useful connections between the two?
Sure. There's a significant and very long shared history between climate and nuclear issues to start with. So when nuclear weapons scientists, mostly at the classified level by our military and the Russian military, early in the development of nuclear weapons during the Cold War, there was significant work in understanding atmospheric sciences in greater depth and understanding the effect that nuclear weapons would have on the atmosphere as part of understanding the damage that these weapons would do to adversaries. And both we in the United States and Russians conducted significant work on this. So all of that work for decades of collecting data on the Earth's atmosphere, seeing different changes, looking at the effects of volcanoes, for example, and things like that, and all of the modeling systems that have been developed over those decades to bring all that data together and get a picture of our atmosphere and how it might change under different circumstances really kind of led the way to at least accelerating climate scientists being able to understand that human beings were then, through greenhouse gas emissions, changing the composition of our atmosphere and driving human-induced climate change as well. So they have that shared connection there. Our current project that we're doing is really looking at sort of contemporary security situations. So security in specific regions and countries, as well as sort of the global landscape of institutions, stability, and things like that. So if you think of, I like to think of just maps overlaid. So if you think of where we have nuclear weapons challenges or nuclear energy, where facilities and nuclear materials have to be safe, dry, guarded, well cared for over decades and decades, take the map of where those nuclear elements exist and where we're worried about those things in the world, and you overlay where the effects of climate change will be hitting and creating different security situations. As some of the previous podcasts have explored, that's already happening in various parts of the world. If you kind of overlay those maps, that's kind of a picture of what we're doing. So think of India and Pakistan, for example. We're very worried about the nuclear situation, the general security dynamics between India and Pakistan. We know that they have significant climate issues, water stress on an ongoing basis. They have fighting over shared water resources. Lots of other historical and other security tensions there, and they have nuclear weapons. Both countries are being devastated by major natural disasters, overwhelming loss of life from heat waves and floods and very severe catastrophes that wind up bringing in their armed forces. And then just the stability of the entire region, and when you bring China and Kashmir into all of that, and Bangladesh, which is also looking at building nuclear reactors now, you get this kind of mix of variables. And our take is that you have to kind of understand that full picture. You can't just look at the kind of nuclear situation between India and Pakistan or within each of those countries. You've got to get that sort of comprehensive picture of how these risks are exacerbating each other or may influence each other in the future. And then that can lead, of course, to a roadmap of what do you do to make things better? What tools do you need? What can we do better to prepare? Try and reduce those risks, unweave those knotty problems that can take off in nonlinear fashions. There are many different types of connections like this in addition to that, including some very literal ones like the Marshall Islands. So the United States conducted nuclear weapons testing in the Marshall Islands in decades past, and there's nuclear material there that And one of the spots that you can now actually watch drone footage online of, there's sort of a containment shell with nuclear materials inside made of concrete and other materials. And the sea, as sea level is rising around the Marshall Islands, that containment dome is getting thwacked and is starting to crack. So there you have very literal climate change and a security risk and a nuclear risk kind of all coming together. So we're seeing examples of these things combining in different ways kind of all over the world. And we want to get ahead of that set of threats, understand them better, and figure out what can be done.
Well, it's a relief to hear that you're working in this space, because when people think nuclear, they immediately associate it with catastrophic risk and a lot of dread and just something, not to, no pun intended, but something nuclear. And so that combination with climate change, which is not normally associated with that same amount of dread, not historically anyway, because it seems so far off and slow moving, it's potentially a way to frame climate change as something that really could exacerbate, as you described, in a way that creates that urgency and that need to address it. And this is a very visual way to look at that. Would you say that that's been helpful for you in terms of trying to get the work through and to address the risks associated with it as such?
Yeah, I think so. And it's interesting, there are different pockets of the communities of interest on climate security side and then on the nuclear side. That really get this inherently. So if you are running a nuclear facility, obviously you're going to be mindful about storms. And there are a lot of these facilities near coastal areas. So sea level rise is definitely something that they want to be on top of. So you find the businesses or countries that have a lot of these facilities kind of already have an understanding that climate change is going to mean something special for them, that they really can't wait until something bad happens, a catastrophe happens, to figure out what to do about it. It's helpful for the security community because, you know, most of us that have grown up in the security studies field obviously have a sense of nuclear risks and how profound they are. So there's, you know, you inherently get what it's like to spend your time thinking about existential risks, of which climate change is also one. So they have that kind of mental and intellectual pairing that's easy for people in the security field, I think. And then there are cadres of people at like our national labs and scientists who, you know, whether you're in modeling or atmospheric sciences or whatever sort of field, data analytics, there's so much crossover in these fields. So there are a lot of, there's sort of a larger community out there that gets the nuclear climate connections and why it's sort of a special layer of concerns that we need to be working on.
So Christine, let's talk about your time at the Department of Defense. Listeners will be fascinated to hear about the projects you oversaw, especially in Asia Pacific and the Middle East. What was your involvement with this multi-year contributing to the international mission to specifically to remove and destroy Syria's chemical weapons? I mean, what a fascinating post that you had then.
Yeah, I was very lucky to be able to serve in that position with the best team in the Department of Defense. I'm absolutely convinced the people that really spend all their days countering weapons of mass destruction are a really special set of civil servants. Really dedicated and smart and diverse, and it was just a wonderful experience. That said, you spend your days trying to think about how to mitigate the worst threats, some of the worst and most catastrophic threats. So there's a lot of bonding, there's a lot of tension and stress, obviously, in these things. Our teams did full span of things. We did nonproliferation treaty compliance, research and development projects. You did capacity building abroad for reducing threats, and it spanned nuclear, chemical, and biological defense programs. So really diverse set of activities that the Department of Defense did. Syria was a very, it was harrowing, but a very special kind of mission. Obviously still devastated that people are still being killed, including by chemical attacks. In Syria and elsewhere. But when the civil war started, and previous podcasts may have explored some of the climatic connections that contributed to what became the civil war in Syria, as the country started to, control of the country started to fall into different hands, al-Nusra Front and other subnational groups were sort of rising up. Assad was losing control of some of his territory. And we and other countries knew that Syria had significant stocks of chemical weapons materials, a lot of them in precursor forms, but some weaponized as well. So as soon as we saw the country sort of gripped by civil war, people fleeing everywhere, started to ask what could we possibly do about these chemical weapons and materials. So we actually started planning. I should just say this is all unclassified in the public as well.
Good to know. Yes,
we started a few years before the actual removal of more than 1,000 tons of Syria's chemical weapons materials to plan out, under different scenarios and different circumstances, what could we possibly do? If Syria split in half and a small amount of the material became gettable, if somebody could go in and grab it and get it, where would we take it and what would we do with it? And there are obviously international laws and treaties that govern some of this as well. And then the technology side, what do you actually do to get rid of these chemicals? And it depends on the type of chemicals and things like that. So our teams spent years really hammering out those different scenarios. So when, after a few years of the civil war, when Assad was losing grip and our government had threatened military action for the use of chemical weapons, there was sort of a little bit of a political opening for the Russians to help convince Assad to join the Chemical Weapons Convention and hand over the chemical weapons materials. Had we not spent a couple of years actually planning for that type of scenario, I'm not sure we would have gotten all those chemicals out. Again, it was more than 1,000 tons. So, well, unfortunately, he still is slaughtering many Syrians with these chemicals. We got rid of a substantial amount of the arsenal. It became a large international effort over time. Lots of countries dedicated personnel, ships, to literally go into the port in Latakia and load up chemicals and bring them out. And they wound up being destroyed with a neutralization system on a ship called the Cape Ray.
Oh, wow.
That the Department of Defense and other U.S. agencies had equipped with specialized gear that was designed really just for destroying Syria's chemical weapons.
So where do chemical versus biological versus nuclear fit into the weapon spectrum and the arsenal of just options to that pose threats to citizens of whatever location? How do you classify them?
So they're normally classified as unconventional weapons or weapons of mass destruction. There's heated debate about the span of them. Obviously, we have we and the Russians and others have enough nuclear weapons to destroy the Earth, the entire Earth, many times over. So in terms of mass destruction, the nuclear weapons, until we can lower their numbers and really bring that number back down, is arguably the largest. But there's a sort of a global deterrence model that we, at least in theory, think is in effect that keeps some of that in check. So many of us actually worry as much, if not more, about chemical weapons and biological weapons. Assad has shown how easy it is to use chemical weapons. The Russians have recently pulled off attacks basically in broad daylight in a NATO-allied country. So I'm very worried still about chemical weapons threats. Biological, as we've seen from pandemics and then models of where disease threats could go, whether they occur naturally or are intentionally dispersed, disease can kill just as many people as the others, if not more, and it's very worrisome. Biological weapons have special additional concerns. Somebody could release a biological agent, for example, North Korea could send folks into Seoul to release a biological agent, and it could be days to weeks before people get sick. So in terms of actually understanding what has happened, is this a natural outbreak? Is it an attack? Countries gaming out whether they were attacked or not, trying to find evidence of that while trying to get whatever it is that's spreading stopped and take care of the people who've gotten sick. Is very complex set of activities and very worrisome, especially in places like the Korean Peninsula, where we still worry about biological weapons existing on a potentially large scale.
So it's not quite as obvious as just knowing exactly where a nuclear warhead was launched from, is it?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, can't see it from space.
Sure.
You may not have an explosion or any sign at all that a biological attack has occurred. Chemicals can be the same, depending on how they're deployed, as we saw in the United Kingdom. So these are all special threats. And the biological as well, we're starting to look at, we have this program to look at the intersection of climate and nuclear security risks. And there's a biological element as well. We know that climate change is changing disease patterns. It's affecting how different vectors move and things like that. So for the center, one of the curiosities is, you know, we have especially our special forces, but there are U.S. military personnel that deploy all around the world. And how do we, some of our programs at the Department of Defense and others really focus on keeping our military personnel safe and healthy wherever they're deployed. But if disease patterns are changing significantly as the effects of climate change hit different parts of the world, then that's going to affect how we look at force health protection, for example.
And is it the same sort of analysts and experts that are exploring all of these together? Do they work, do they communicate and collaborate when they're looking at all of these various threats and the spectrum of weapons and everything that you just described? I mean, it looks like they're all related in some way.
Yeah, and so the good news is that a lot of this already happens. So our disease monitoring systems are linked up with environmental monitoring systems, since obviously the two are coupled. So there's a lot of, and we have systems for pulling in atmospheric data and looking at plume analysis for if there was a nuclear, chemical, or biological attack, how would it be carried? Where would it go? Where would the radiation or biological agent or whatever it is transfer based on the atmospheric patterns that we see? So there are a lot of data systems and models and things like that that already exist that pull in these environmental and other factors. And that's a really fruitful area. It's also in terms of thinking about policy action. You know, you could get, we think it would be great if, you know, these common interests of continuous data and still investing in the technology of these models, maybe pulling in AI systems and things like that. There's a lot of common ground between sort of the climate and environmental communities and the defense communities that look at weapons of mass destruction. And you could get a lot of, I think, more support for those types of technologies and capabilities if those communities sort of synced up a little bit more on the policy side.
Sure, and I think as conditions are changing, we're seeing that increased breakdown of siloed work and a lot more of that collaboration and cross-effort help that really just informs and furthers the work that's being done across the whole spectrum. So that's really good to know in here. So what are you seeing in terms of innovation and advances? You just mentioned AI. What are some of the opportunities that excite you in this area?
Mm-hmm. So one of the greatest ones is, I always try to think back, you know, what is the hat of somebody who's sitting at the Department of Defense or some other agency? And what are you, in terms of having a lot of dollars that you're investing in the strategy for how do you prepare for the future better and things like that, how do you actually know what the future is going to hold, right? And that's obviously a very, very complex question. But some of these I've gotten a little bit of a sneak peek of some of the AI systems, for example, that can take thousands and thousands of trends and data points, some things that you would, an individual would take years to pull out that data together, but there would be no way to understand it all. We have systems now that can sort of take that human fallibility in understanding future threats out of it. Obviously, there's some worry about that. There's a dangerous kind of slippery slope it could go down. But if I'm saying, you know, there's this particular region, look at the Middle East with Iran and the nuclear situation and all the countries there that are developing nuclear power, they obviously have, some countries are unstable. There are rivalries and certainly low-grade security kind of threats and fighting that occur all across the region on a normal basis. There are terrorist concerns, things like that. There's massive water scarcity issues. How do you look at all of those factors and think, what's the region actually going to look like? And where are the threats going to be the most acute that we need to get ahead of, say, in 5-10 years? And then I think that's going to allow us to go back to today and kind of hopefully mitigate a lot of threats before they occur in a way that we really couldn't do before. It's just no one is really able to analyze what threats are actually going to emerge and what aren't. It's a very complex question, but again, we know the general factors behind stability and instability and things like that. So
there's a lot of innovation in the pipeline that is going to make a lot of this work that much easier, not to take away at all from just how difficult it is and complex. But based on what we do know, I mean, clearly there's so much that's already been done and is happening based on the information we already have. Who's responsible? Where is the proactive nature here? Are you From your perspective, do you see that happening? Are you happy with the action that's underway currently based on what we know?
No, and some of it's just general protection of programs that have already existed, right? So we look at our nonproliferation programs and countering weapons of mass destruction programs, and a lot of them have seen significant budget decreases for really, really important programs in recent years. And this going back even into the previous administrations as well, but certainly very much in this year, the past couple of years. And then in the, again, the capabilities of the national labs, the supporting our innovation and modeling and analytics and things like that, that is cross-cutting and can help us in so many different security domains, is critically important. But some of the monitoring and data collection capabilities have, again, seen budget cuts introduced. So I would love to see, again, all these communities come together to support good, strong budgets for investing in technology and capability that can help us across these different security issues.
So that's the current situation. And then looking to the future, the next generation, and what opportunities they will probably have to advance some of this work. So you at Johns Hopkins here in Washington, D.C., as part of the Global Security Studies Program, what types of things are you seeing your students concerned about as they talk about these threats that will potentially affect their generation more than even the current generation? What do you tell them their opportunities are and what they can do to make a difference?
Mm-hmm. So one of the good things about the Global Security Studies program is that a lot of our students, since it's a master's degree program, are already working in government, and most of them are already involved in security in one way. Although obviously we have students who are interested in entering the field too. They have opportunities that I could not even dream of as well. So I have a former student running for Congress and one who, hopefully, she'll win. I have another who's a White House correspondent. They all find amazing careers to do with these security studies degrees. And what we try and instill is the things that we're learning, even if they don't seem to lead to a specific job in a specific course, we're really equipping them with good critical thinking skills in a way of understanding change in the world, and that nothing is static, and that you can't, you know, sit at a desk in Washington, D.C. and read a bunch of books and pretend that you're going to know how things are going to occur in the world and how events are going to unfold. So I'm finding that the students come away with that sense of dynamism, which I think will prepare them for any career in a way that, you know, the way that I was trained, for example, memorizing treaty texts and things like that was very important. Appreciate my education. But we didn't quite get instilled just how much the world was going to change, including on the technology side, and what that would mean for nonproliferation and threat reduction and addressing existential risks like climate change and nuclear threats. So hopefully, I think the next generations, you know, we're seeing constantly people just sort of have that sense. They grew up in a world where that was the case, you know, have had an internet since they were born, basically. So I think that the next generations are going to be much better equipped, frankly, than my previous generations have been to deal with just the complexity of the security environment.
Yes, well, I mean, listening to you, you're giving me hope, not just for the future generation, but also the smart people that you've worked with in your tenure at the Department of Defense. So I feel heartened. I feel listeners will take that away. And so thank you for sharing that with them. Is there anything you'd like to leave listeners with that they can do to address some of these threats that we all collectively are facing?
Just pay attention. Any listener, whether you're in the security field or not, just be aware that all of these different issues are occurring. They're unfolding right before our eyes. And just even reading the news and being apprised, I think, can make sure that when we're thinking about our own lives and actions, and then policy and things like that, that it's informed by just how dynamic the world is out there.
Excellent. Well, thank you so much for taking this time and sharing your views with us. It's really informative and much appreciated. Thank you, Christine, for being with me today.
Thank you for having me.
Thank you for listening to the Climate and Security Podcast. We'd love to hear from you. Please tweet me directly at SWETAC or the Center for Climate and Security's Twitter handle. If you enjoyed today's conversation, please subscribe, write a review on iTunes, share widely, and finally, consider donating to the podcast from the Center of Climate and Security's podcast page, www.climateandsecurity.org/podcast, by clicking on Make a Donation.
We will continue the series of conversations with the most prolific and dedicated folks in this space, and your support is greatly appreciated. Thank you, and please tune in again for the next episode of the Climate and Security Podcast.